Whatever happened to your friendly neighborhood copper? He changed, and so did the neighborhood. In a violent society, we ask a lot of the police, perhaps too much.
In the police force, they've got an unwritten rule. If you speak out, you get out. So we don't hear about the policeman who puts a few bullets through his desk in frustration and walks out on the job, or the one who loses a police car. But they're there. The good copper, even the best one, has a problem. It is that he's only human. He must be fit and intelligent, patient and disciplined, honest, fair, cool and courteous, yet tough. Make him a servant of the public, then abuse him, accuse him, overwork him, put him in fear of his life, and don't be surprised if he cracks. Every year in Australia, hundreds of highly trained senior police give up their jobs. It's more than that. They give up a career of public service many began as teenagers. Jim Downes reports on why the older men are going and how the younger ones will cope with the risk and stress of police work in the 80s.
Now, with your paintings and with your acting this morning, you've been thinking about what is a policeman or a policewoman to you. Now we're going to talk about it. Who's going to be first?
Clifford in the blue parka.
I'd like to be a policeman who drives an unmarked police car.
What would you like to do, Clifford? What would
chase
you...
Chase people.
Would you...
I'd like to be a sergeant.
What sort of jobs would you see that a sergeant does? What do you think a sergeant would do?
Go out and help people.
Well, where do you start in the police force?
Jason, do you know?
It's sort of like cubs. You go in a hall and the police teach you what to do and...
Substituting your own several names for mine, please repeat after me the following.
It's really not at all like cubs. And anyone who came here thinking to be a grown-up Boy Scout wouldn't last long.
I
do swear that.
Do swear that.
I will well and truly serve.
I will well and truly serve.
Our Sovereign Lady the Queen.
Our Sovereign Lady the Queen.
In the office of Constable of Police.
In the office of Constable of Police.
Without favour or affection.
Without favour or affection.
Malice or ill will.
Malice or ill will.
Graduates of the New South Wales Police Academy in Sydney. A moment ago, they were civilians in uniform. But that oath made them police. People apart, different, and increasingly removed from the society which appoints and employs them, and having appointed, wants as little as possible to do with them. Their primary promise to keep and preserve the peace expands into the oversight of hundreds and thousands of rules and regulations, laws and statutes, the do's and don'ts of the society from which they're drawn, and in which they must live as well as work.
All offences against the same.
All offences against
the job, they call it. And the job is getting harder all the time, in a society increasingly lawless, increasingly violent, and ready to polarise on any issue from football to politics. Just waiting, it seems, for an excuse to show the cops a thing or two. The closing down of a pub in Newcastle when a rout turned into a riot.
That I will see and cause.
That I will see and cause.
Her Majesty's peace to be kept and preserved.
Her Majesty's peace to be kept and preserved.
And that. I will prevent to the best of my power.
I will prevent to the best of my power.
All offences against the same.
All offences against the same.
And that. While I continue to hold the said office.
While I continue to hold the said office.
I will. To the best of my skill and knowledge.
To the best of my skill and knowledge.
Discharge all the duties thereof.
Discharge all the duties thereof.
faithfully,
faithfully,
according to law,
according to law.
So help me God.
So help me God.
It causes you to start to think about what you're doing, or is it really worthwhile? You start to look at a broader aspect of the society, and you think, well, you know, is it really worth it, you know, because, I mean...
Don McNeil, until 2 years ago, a policeman, a detective in Victoria, retired in his early 40s because his health failed under the stress of the job.
I think I can sum it up in the fact that I lost the desire to serve. I looked at the community I was serving and what they were putting up with.
Don McNeil represents an alarming Australian police statistic that more than ever before, men are being retired because stress has broken them.
In that you start then to lose your objectivity and as an investigator, and you start, you know, well, with me it was just a slow disintegration, but it was a pretty complete one.
It's the fact that in 1961, 20 years ago, our ill health retirement rate was 6 per year. Last year we lost 120 ill health retirement people, and this year, the way it's going, in the first 6 months we've had 100 police officers before the government medical officer with a view to retirement. Now that would represent 200 for this year.
It is a rather insidious thing. It's that happens in your day-to-day work, in some of the horrific things that you see or have to, you know, take part in. And you're trained, you know, you get your training, you know, is of the order that you cope with that, and that you you perform your duties accordingly. But I think that it without you realizing it, I think that it probably catches up with you.
There has been a murder this night in a laneway in an ethnic quarter of Coburg, Melbourne. The local police, first on the scene, are understanding orders to do nothing, touch nothing, until the experts arrive. The murder squad men, called on duty from home, and likely now to work 20, 30, 40 hours without a break. Women police, to break the news to relatives. Scientific police to probe and measure and photograph. The Victoria Police Union says the force is 25% under strength, and three men must do the work of four. Overtime is part of life for policemen. Days off are cancelled, leave deferred. The effect on personal lives can be disastrous.
Well, we've got a pretty serious marriage breakdown problem. I know many police officers who are now into their third marriage. We have a fairly difficult problem with liquor among some of our people. You know, if you're being bounced around in a high risk and high pressure area for long periods of time, the tendency is to go and let off a bit of steam with a few ales. The problem becomes manifest when you have to lean on those few aisles to exist.
Policemen are fond of saying they're like everyone else, the same feelings, the same opinions as the society they come from. Which must mean that some of these New Zealand policemen, fighting rioters over the Springboks football tour, must themselves share the beliefs of the rioters. In the anti-Vietnam War demonstrations in Australia a decade ago, some police certainly were privately sympathetic to the demonstrators' cause. Publicly, though, they did as they were told and tried to keep the peace. On this occasion, to protect the Canberra presence of the American vice president at the time, Spiro Agnew, not long after to be exposed and disgraced. In Melbourne a few weeks ago, the greatest police mobilisation of our time protected visiting Commonwealth politicians, and police found themselves escorting, protecting, saluting, but mostly waiting around for people who other police in other places just a few years ago would have arrested or shot on sight. such as this man, once a Rhodesian terrorist with a price on his head, now the top man in Zimbabwe. In the course of guarding Mr. Mugabe and his Commonwealth colleagues, Victoria's police force rearranged Melbourne's traffic system and won few friends among drivers while so doing. Police worked extraordinary hours. Stations in suburbs and country towns were stripped of staff. Some men didn't see their homes for 10 or 12 days. It was said officially to have been something of a triumph for Victoria Police and a boost to morale. But the official view didn't come from the copper on the job. He, by and large, was bored and frustrated and said freely, though privately, he'd be better employed at his real job at his usual station. But publicly, he was stoic and silent and did as he was told by his political masters. That's another source of police stress, and there's a phrase for it, role conflict.
Right, baton work. The first technique we're going to do is a forward thrust from our defensive position. That is holding the baton about chest height, or waist, just above between chest and waist level, and simply thrusting forward off the front foot to somebody's middle level. Straightforward thrust off the baton. Nice and relaxed, nice and easy. Withdrawing back into the original position. Right, taking the count from me, on the count. Right, one, two, three.
Only 1 or 2% of people might encounter police in this way. Yet police training is overwhelmingly concentrated on dealing with that 1 or 2%. How much does this colour police attitudes towards the rest of us? Are we all, in police eyes, potential villains? So the only people a policeman feels he can trust are other police. And what happens then when some police themselves are found dishonest, corrupt, bent? For the straight cop, that can be the worst stress of all, because all suffer from the corruption of a few. Victoria trains its new police at a former seminary, once called Corpus Christi, in suburban Melbourne. Its inmates call it Coppers Christi, though a bishop's mitre, not a policeman's helmet, graces the portals.
It's funny, since I've been in here, I've become sort of a more suspicious person than what I was before. I sort of, you know, you walk around and you'll see things come to your attention and you'll think, oh, you know, I wouldn't mind pulling him over or something like that, you know. Just things like that, just from being in here and doing the course.
A few days before the end of their 20 weeks training, these Victorian police recruits talked about their training and their expectations.
Do you find yourself getting at all suspicious of people now that you wouldn't have been before?
No, I've always been very nosy. I sort of tend to sit back and or listen a lot more to what people are talking to. Not so much their conversation, but the way they're saying things, their actions while they do it.
Through the laws you've learnt, you realise things before that you just didn't see before. And you just get a suspicious mind. I don't know why. It just sort of grows.
I feel prepared in the theory field, but you can't get taught experience. And hopefully if we get taught by members who have been around an X amount of years, we can gain the experience. But as I said, to gain experience, first of all, takes years. So we'll be lost like sheep for a little while.
What we're going to be talking about today is police attending to domestic trouble.
Ask a policeman the part of his job he most dislikes, even dreads. And chances are he'll say domestics. Domestics, the cover word for family violence, when dad belts mum. Increasingly these days, mum is belting dad. And young men and women like these must go in as peacemakers, dealing often with people old enough to be their parents, angry people, disturbed or drunk or both.
Your first job is to be alert for danger.
Oh, who is it? Oh, Mr. Punch. Open up in the name of the law. Oh, dear me, it's a policeman. I don't want a policeman. No, Mr. Punch. But a policeman wants you. You just killed your wife. You threw her out of the window and she fell on my head. Ha, 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 ha. That must have been funny, mustn't it, girls and boys? Mr. Punch, it was not funny. Oh, you can't take me to jail. I'm not going to go to jail. Mr. Punch, you are. No, I'm not. Ooh. Ha, ha, ha. That's the way you do it. Ha, ha, ha.
In Sydney's western suburbs, two policemen were shotgunned to death at a domestic, and that totally changed police perception of the risks involved.
They're in a job which is very stressful, not only physically but emotionally. Many of them deal with emotional stress by attempting to repress it, and they deal with the sense that they're not coping by again attempting to repress that and keeping that hidden, not only from others but from themselves too. Many of them feel angry and bitter towards themselves. They see themselves as having failed. They see themselves as having been weak and having crumbled with the pressure that's been put upon them.
Dr. Michael Epstein, a Melbourne psychiatrist, is studying police stress. He finds a parallel between the stress reactions of policemen and of veterans of the Vietnam War.
These policemen and Vietnam veterans have emotional symptoms including depression, anxiety, loss of self-esteem, crying. They have physiological symptoms. Their sleep is disturbed, their appetite is disturbed, their energy level is impaired. They frequently find they have a fine tremor. They find that their thinking is impaired, with problems with memory, with concentration, with making decisions. Socially, they find themselves seclusive, they're irritable. They find their libido is often considerably lowered. Now, this same group of symptoms have been described amongst policemen, amongst Vietnam veterans, and amongst the other groups that I mentioned. And amongst the Vietnam veterans, the important factor seems to be length of exposure to combat. The more combat experience you've had, the more likely you are to have developed these symptoms. It seems to be relatively unrelated to your previous life experience. And I find the same thing with policemen. Policemen who are in high-risk areas, for example, inner suburban areas, where there is sometimes a warlike situation, they're the ones who are most likely to break down.
To fight the battles which can erupt in suburban streets, a new kind of policeman makes an occasional appearance. These are some of that new kind of policeman, and they're not preparing decorations for the policeman's ball. In their own language, they are snipers. Officially, their group is called the Special Weapons Squad, and their specialty is shooting. Accurate shooting.
It's a test though if you've got to pick a colour.
They are, to put it crudely, executioners. And theirs is an awesome responsibility, to kill on the spot the terrorist, the deranged, the holder of hostages.
All right, fellas, we're going to do the short countdown method as we done yesterday. The target will be designated at various ranges, and the colour coding will be according to your target. I'll nominate the balloons, and it'll be on a short countdown of 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and on the stroke of one, both shooters will fire off together.
Their air of menace, not wholly unintentional, is strengthened by the anonymity of the black, undecorated battle dress they wear. And they've a language of their own, in which to kill becomes to take out. Each man has his own rifle, loads his own ammunition, because the factory stuff isn't accurate enough.
Your name and bright light, Leroy.
This exercise on an army range is to see if they're good enough with a gun to take out two gunmen 100 metres away and leave unharmed the hostage, thus the balloons.
Target front on a short countdown of 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
How you see such men depends upon whether you are the potential gunman or the hostage, which is different only in degree from whether you have been booked for speeding or are the victim of a bashing or robbery. Or if it's your street in which someone has gone berserk with a gun. This was a siege in the salubrious Sydney suburb Rose Bay, and the life of each of these policemen was at risk. Before it ended, the gunman was dead and one policeman grievously wounded. And that's a possibility for every frontline policeman every working day.
What do you do with the policeman who is physically fit, who has either been shot or has looked down the wrong end of a pistol or rifle, and then doesn't ever get back to work? He's always got the inherent fear that the next time he steps out of a station, he'll be seeing the same thing or facing the same problem. It's unlikely, but it could happen. Fortunately, a large number of them, when they have faced these situations, just shrug their shoulders and go on with the job.
Get into this car!
At a ceremony in Melbourne, society bestows its reward for being shot at, the Police Medal for Valour. That the recipient is alive to collect it is a matter of chance, and that a thug with a gun found it hard to shoot straight from a moving car.
Oh, I didn't sleep very well that night or the night after. Oh, that night I went home and had a few beers, went to bed about 5 in the morning, was still wide awake. The next night I went to bed sober and I could not sleep at all. I was up and down and tossing and turning.
Has it bothered you since?
Not a great deal. I got a tape of the radio conversation that we had, and I play that occasionally, and it still gives me a flutter when I hear it. I get all fidgety and jump up and down from the chair I'm in.
Do you find it a stressful job?
Oh, there's times you feel like tearing your hair out, but I think you have to take it all with a grain of salt. And when it starts getting you down, just start laughing a bit, and it's all right after that.
Governments who employ policemen, and who very much need to have them on side, are in a dilemma on the issue of police stress. Because stress has become a factor in industrial argument, and already in Victoria, pay rates have been influenced by it. So governments, as the employers, need to minimise the stress factor. But to do so is to risk a change in the traditionally docile attitude of police unions. The Victorian Minister for Police, Jock Grunter.
There appears to be an increasing retirement list on grounds of ill health in the Victoria Police each year, getting this year, I'm told, somewhere close to 200 people. Does that disturb you?
Well, it disturbs me, yes. There are health and stress problems and problems that people have in all walks of life and occupations. And I don't think the Victorian Police Force has any greater problem than police forces throughout Australia. In particular, I would say they have less.
But nevertheless, the stress factor does appear to be causing an increasing wastage of police.
It doesn't appear to come through to me that way. There is about 4% retirements and for ill health and other reasons in the Victorian Police Force. I have discussed it with the Chief Commissioner, and he advises me that whilst it is a concern, it's no greater concern than it has been in past years.
That the ill health retirement numbers are not in fact increasing yet?
Well, I think they are increasing a little bit, but also our numbers in the police force are increasing year by year and will continue to increase. And for that factor alone, we must have a few extra retirements and people retiring for sick health reasons.
In 1960, when the Victorian Police Force was about 4,000, 6 men left the force because of ill health. In 1981, with a force of 8,000, that's the force doubled, there'll be about 200. So there's a significant increase. The factors that seem to be involved with that are that the workload is increasing quite dramatically, but hasn't been a commensurate increase in resources available to policemen. The force is now 25% under strength, so that you've got 3 policemen doing the job of 4. As well, their resources are inadequate. For example, at one stage, the homicide squad was using taxis to get to murders. The accommodation is poor, and because of the lack of men, many policemen are having to work extra long shifts, which in turn takes its toll.
We do expect rather a lot of them, don't we?
Yes. You expect integrity. You expect them to be available. You expect them to be presentable. And you expect them to help you when you're in trouble. And when you think about it, would you like to have to fulfill all these functions at a moment's notice?
There's more to the management of stress than a cold shower and a run around the Oval. Police recruits are made pretty fit by their 20 weeks training. But once that's over, their fitness is rarely, if ever, checked again. As for psychological fitness, the signs are there in the premature retirement lists that the problem exists and it's getting worse.
That report from Jim Downs. Because Christianity has been embraced for so long now by the establishment, in principle, if not always in practice, it's easy to forget that it began on the fringes of society. The first Christians were outsiders, a minority, different from other men. They questioned the status quo, peacefully enough, but they were feared and persecuted. A couple of thousand years later, one October night in Melbourne, a publican put 12 men out of his hotel. They were young. They were drinking lemon squash and sarsaparilla. Most wore beards. Their coats were made of leather. They told the publican that they were members of the God Squad. To them, that meant Christians. To him, that meant bikies. No bikies allowed in my hotel, he said. And he told their leader to remove them. Their leader was a man called John Smith.
Well, it's not the only way I dress, it's not the only hat I wear, it's not the only culture that I move in. And even if it was, there are lots of other people dealing with other cultures. But these guys have been left right out for as long as I know how, and I just can't imagine any impact into that often very lonely world by a guy with his collar back to front and looking like Mr. Straight. It's just not going to happen.
That's the philosophy of a man who's no longer as anonymous as his name. John Smith, pastor, evangelist, and oft-hailed prophet, first donned leathers and helmet more than a decade ago in an attempt to reach Melbourne's outlaw bikie gangs. In a city renowned for its churches, John Smith shuns them. Instead, his visits to Adelaide concentrate on schools and the occasional evening rally, like this one in Salisbury.
Thank you.
The music suggests Byers and Dylan, but the message of John Smith carries an urgency and sometimes an anger that relates far more to the ugly 80s than the swinging 60s.
And we've been saying this week that the time is well gone now where we can afford to congratulate ourselves as a country. We've reached a point where we have to be realistic about it, that the triple-fronted brick veneer, or whatever it becomes now, the particular form of house changes from decade to decade, but the kind of having your own home, even that has not brought to us the kind of thing that we long for within our hearts. And it seems that it's not so much the Christians that are saying it now, it's very much the secular leaders who are warning us about the shape of our nation. It's people like Manning Clark, for whom I have tremendous admiration, and people like Bob Hawke and others who've said much about the shape of the nation and about care for people. I feel that very strongly. It disturbs me that in a land where we give ourselves the title, a lucky country, we have one of the worst barbiturate dependency rates in the world. I understand in my district, and I live in one of the worst of the suburbs, but I understand in my district that just ordinary middle-class housewives have amongst the worst dependency on barbiturates in the whole world. That disturbs me. I can't sit by and just watch that, and I want to address myself tonight to some of these things. Do you need?
Adelaide's Rundle Mall. John Smith has become a familiar figure in South Australia since he joined forces with the local Christian youth group several years ago.
Stand by for spontaneous applause. Ready? Now!
Well, it was just lovely to see him back a second time too, because...
Approaching 40, with greying black beard and a hairstyle unchanged from the 60s, John Smith is a dropout from what might have been a conventional ministry. His father is a Methodist minister in Queensland. John Smith followed in his father's footsteps and graduated from the Melbourne Bible Institute in 1967. His politics moved from extreme right to left, and his interest in the established church waned as he worked increasingly amongst bikies and drug addicts.
Very different kettle of fish because they all have strong Christian commitment and they're loving guys, they're caring guys, they're not so desperately concerned about their egos. But out there in the street, the bike world is a varied world. You just can't typecast it. There are intellectuals. I've met some pretty tough guys in the bike scene that spun out from the Vietnam War and they just hate society and this is the way they express it. There are others that are just freewheeling American easy rider types that just want to have a ball and they're just out there relaxing and they want to do their thing. I think there are some who have serious, angry, almost psychotic tendencies at times. But most of them are just ordinary blokes, most of them working class, I think. And most of them either wanting to do their own thing, wanting to find identity by belonging to such a group, or feeling pretty angry about the way in which the society's kept them on the outside.
Why would some of the guys here in the club have left the regular bikie scene and moved to the God Squad?
That's a touchy one. For most of them, it's because they've found a relationship with God, they feel. They've found a relationship with their fellow man that's very different to what they had before. They're very changed fellas. I guess it'd be better really to ask them than to ask me that. I'd rather them
But what of their previous life would they give up to join the God Squad?
Well, they give up getting smashed on the weekends. They give up about 10 times the chance of smashing off the road because they're high as a kite or because they're drunk. They give up getting their faces smashed in when they get angry with somebody and they're drunk and start a brawl. I mean, I think a lot of the things they've given up, quite frankly, are things well worth giving up.
Right. And as far as the public's concerned, well, it'll never be a good image. You can ride around on a motorbike with a sheet wrapped around your hand and out dollar bills, and there's a certain aspect of people that will still want to run you over and give you real hate looks and fix you right up. But along with that, coupled with that is the stereotype picture of what a Christian is, you know? I mean, most films and TV shows you see a Christian or the minister is a sort of a village idiot figure. And as far as we're concerned, you wear leather and you dress like you do rather than lose skin if you fall off.
And what about the motorist reaction to seeing God Squad on your back? Does that make him think that you're any different from any of the other bikie clubs around town?
Nothing for the police.
Half of them wouldn't know the difference.
How do the police...
Well, they treat us... We get treated roughly the same, you know. I mean, we get pulled up if we're doing the wrong thing or checked, just license checks, just like anybody else. I feel that's part of it. I mean, we shouldn't be isolated just because we wear a patch on our back. We are people in society. We've got to be treated like that, I think, and we've got to... If we break the law and we're going too fast, we've got to be pulled up for it.
But as Christians who are trying to also attract others to Christ, don't you find that perhaps your bikey garb, your jackets and that tend to scare people away rather than attract them?
That's the magic of it. That's the right word. It really identifies. Like, I can pull up on bike and I can sit in the gutter and I'll get a group of kids around me because I've got a motorcycle. It's a sort of a genius thing. We're not a bunch of phonies that have got on bikes to sort of lure people to Christianity. We're bike riders that have been riding for a lot of years and like bikes and find that it really identifies with a lot of other kids. Now, the kids we want to reach, we're interested in everybody, but there's a whole group of young people and older people that are disillusioned with the church, that are really outside of it, and they see us and they feel, hey, that guy's like me. You know, we're the same. And whether it's a dope freak or a guy, a biker or a young kid in trouble with the law or whatever, he feels though he can identify with us. So if Mr. Straight doesn't like me because I'm a biker, I guess that's too bad.
But what about giving up things that bikers are usually traditionally associated with? Birds, booze, drugs. Those things you've given up, haven't you?
Well, I haven't given them up. Yes, I'm a married man. I've got a beautiful wife and little baby girl, and they're the good things in life I enjoy now. Whereas before, you know, sure, I'd be off my head a lot of times. No value in that. And as I said, I feel like I'm a real free man, and that's the sort of thing that I haven't given that up. That's just been something that was dragging me down.
The God Squad, which grew out of John Smith's first contact with bikies, has now become just one aspect of a far wider ministry. Out of the God Squad has grown the Truth and Liberation Concern, a loosely organised congregation that is centred on the outer Melbourne suburb of North Bayswater. Here, bikies and young families join each Sunday morning for a weekly service. The building is as unconventional as the congregation it houses. John Smith doesn't call it a church. It's a building, he says, purely functional and, if needs be, readily disposable.
It's a very young congregation. The majority would be in their 20s, 30s, those of us that are touching 40 or into the 40s, quite a few now, but that I think would be a minority. Sociologically, I think the majority of the congregation would be in the lower economic income level, but there are professional people, there are many students who are interested in searching issues out, there are many deserted wives and deserted husbands, a lot of divorcees. There are many people who've been through drug experiences, prison experiences, broken relationship experiences of a serious sort. We have people here who've been through the horror of incest, of violence, of alcoholism. It's a congregation really made up of, mostly of either people who have been on the other side of the tracks or people who feel deeply concerned for those who have.
Monday lunchtime at Nidri High School in Melbourne. John Smith and God Squad have become regular visitors to many schools in Victoria and South Australia. He doesn't seem to proselytise. He speaks mainly of his own Christian view of politics, economics and social issues as they affect youth in Australia. Invariably, John Smith quotes Bob Hawke, Manning Clark or Henry Lawson, men better known for their socialist rather than their Christian faith.
They have a longing for a better world. They're not prepared to accept things as they are. And that's very dear to the heart of anybody, I think, that knows Christ. They're mostly children of the parsonage, or the manse, so to speak. And I think their disillusionment is not so much with the core of the kind of world that Jesus talked about. I think it's more to do with the way in which we as Christians have not been Christian. And they are men with this longing for justice, for a changed world. They've sought to do it on the basis of secular humanism. I feel anguish for them because my conviction is that that the human race seeks a father, and the cries of its orphanhood cannot be answered by secular humanism. So I feel both a great respect for them as men of integrity, men of justice, men of compassion.
I'm deeply distressed and angry as I see that. I just can't add up Chogham conferences.
John Smith, with his nationalist, mildly left-wing Christian views, has won a surprisingly wide acceptance in the schools of South Australia and Victoria. His views might not always be in accord with the established churches, but even his critics admit that he always leaves his audiences with plenty to think about.
I'm convinced that Australia is really in trouble. There's hardly a book been written by a social analyst in the last 10 years that has not said we're in trouble. Poor Little Rich Country is a typical title for Australian books. The land of the long weekend, where only long weekends bring any significance into life. All sorts of titles like that serve notice we are in trouble. And unless your generation comes to grips with it, then I don't know there's much future for this nation. And that's why we're here. We believe that our parents missed out on it. My generation has stuffed it really badly. And your generation is a hope for tomorrow. Don't sink it. Don't dismiss the thought. Don't lay aside the questions of meaning and purpose like my generation did. Do it now before your lives are stuck in a rut you can't break out of. While you're free and able to do it, ask the real questions and find some real answers, not only for your own sakes, but for the sake of our nation at this time in such need of moral and spiritual and real leadership. God bless you. And thanks for being a great audience.
Richard Palfreyman reporting. And now to next week on Four Corners. Industrial Japan, where robots make other robots, where unions and management plan a future together, and where the boss greets his workers every morning. All part of the Japanese way, to see a job well done. But are the Japanese waking up from their post-war dream of industrial harmony? Is there more to life than serving the company? Walter Hamilton reports on Japan's industrial revolution next on Four Corners. And until next week, good night.